Balaw. Kailangan nyo ito.
Hi, Carl. How
are you?
Welcome. USD Theological Society welcomes you to our International Lecture for Theology. May I call on Brother Ray Sabuero from the Sons of St. Anne for our invocation. We all stand, and please remain standing after which for our pagpapansang.
We offer everything to you during this lecture. May we ask for your blessing and divine providence that the activities set for this undertaking be successful and effective. May we also retain the invaluable knowledge and learning experiences that we derive from this activity and for actual application when we leave this venue. We ask you in special way to bless our speaker, Right Reverend Olexander Kenez, that may you inspire him always with your great example. Your generous blessing would mean the success of this lecture. We know that without it, we can do nothing. May we be living witnesses of your genuine love through the implementation of the knowledge acquired through this activity. Grant us your divine wisdom as we go about our daily task after this lecture. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Theology from the Order of Preachers, Reverend Father Rodel P. Aliga. Round of applause. Please.
Father Winston Cabani, the Secretary General, our distinguished guest for this afternoon, Reverend Fathers, our Antiochian Fathers present, the administrators, the members of the faculty, the students of the ecclesiastical faculty, the students of the Immaculate Conception Seminary, Reverend Sisters, my dear catechists, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. There has been a sudden interest nowadays by Christians and Catholics alike of going back to the sources of tradition of the practices of the early church. Thus, you have such resurgence and interest, for example, in the Trident and Mass, the use of Latin in the liturgy, and even a reformulation in the order of the Mass of the Roman Rite. Just this morning, I heard from the news that Pope Benedict XVI has encouraged the study and use of Latin not only for the ministers of the church, but for the whole church as well. For a start, in his Twitter account, yes, he will be tweeting Latin quotations and words of inspiration in the same language. I don't know if some of you can follow him, also in Latin. On the other hand, the Church is involved in interreligious and ecumenical dialogues with other faiths and cultures, and communion with other churches within the Catholic Church. Whether it is a path or not, going back to the roots is always the right thing to do for a Christian. There is always beauty in unity and diversity. In fact, we can never exclude and ignore the diversity of expressions and forms of worship in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. And I do hope that that this lecture of our distinguished speaker would tell us the how and why of the witness of the Eastern Catholic Church in the one holy Apostolic Church. I'm very sure this would be very interesting for all of us. So in behalf of the ecclesiastical faculty, especially the Faculty of Sacred Theology, thank you very much for coming. And to our distinguished speaker, we appreciate your being here with us in the university. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Father. Seminarian Casciano Anthony Kotyanko will now introduce to us our speaker.
Good afternoon. Our speaker was born on the 27th of June, 1952 in Australia. He graduated from Angelicum University in Rome in the year 1982. Ordained to the priesthood in the 29th of June, 1983 in Stamford, Massachusetts, and received a master's degree in patristics from the Holy Cross College, Boston, Connecticut. In 1991, he went to Lviv, Ukraine, to help establish a seminary just before the fall of communism. He returned to Australia in 1991 and was appointed Vicar General and Chancellor. In 1997, he was appointed to Stella Maris organization and to maritime chaplaincy in the port of Melbourne. He taught patristics from 1997 in St. John Mary Vianney Seminary in Wagga Wagga, New South Wales, Australia. And in 1998, he began his internet ministry. In 2011, he went to Hong Kong to present a series of lectures and liturgies introducing the Byzantine liturgy and spirituality. Our speaker for today is Right Reverend Olexander Kenez, the Vicar General of Ukrainian Catholic Eparchy of Australia. A round of applause, please.
Before I start, the wonders of the 21st century. Once upon a time, this person giving a speech would have, you know, sheets of lecture notes and losing half of them in the process, and now God created the iPad. First of all, I need to acknowledge the order of preachers who have been constantly supporting the Eastern Church throughout the ages. There were the Fratres Peregrinos, Fratres Peregrinos, that were involved in going to places like Armenia and Ukraine and establishing themselves and adopting the way of prayer of the Eastern Church. Then the Benedictine Fathers, whose involvement in the liturgical prayer of the East has been fundamental for centuries. For goodness sake, they have a monastery in Sheftonia that that part of the corridor is Latin, that part of the corridor is Byzantine. And the Society of Jesus, who have also played a massive role in supporting the Eastern Church throughout the ages. I'm not known for being nice, you know. I'm a big boy. I'm 186 centimeters tall. I can deadlift 210 kilograms, but there's one person that I'm absolutely terrified of. She's a nun. She's about that high, and whenever I see it in high school, the sister always told you, you had to clean your shoes. And whenever you saw a nun, you sort of made sure your shoes were clean. To this day, I see this, I see Reverend Mother, and she says, Father, don't bother. You didn't clean your shoes for 3 days. But that's that. Okay. Let us begin. The Byzantine Experience. An FGCC multimedia presentation. If you want to know what FGCC stands for, give it a bit of thought. The Byzantine Experience, I'm not going to try to conquer the whole of the theological ramifications of the Byzantine East in one lecture. That can't be done. I want to open a few windows for you so that a lot of you can discover that the church breathes with two lungs, and to understand and to have a little glimpse into something that might be a bit different for a lot of us. Hagia Sophia, the Church of the Holy Wisdom of God. This is the essentially the Mother Church of Christendom. The whole concept of church believing community comes in here. There is symbolism in everything. This tells you that there is another way of looking at things. Imagine the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire was huge, definitely huge. And they had two capitals, one in Rome and one in Constantinople. And people. The people in Rome, if there was a law passed, by the way, I am, as of the day before yesterday, almost Filipino. Hey, I've eaten balut, and there's a Facebook video showing me eating it. You're not going to tell a Filipino that he's not allowed to eat balut, and you're not going to tell an Italian that eating pasta is a criminal offense. People express themselves in different ways. What did Rome give the world? Two basic things. Rome gave the world the road, very important, communication, and Pax Romana. Somebody here, what does Pax Romana mean? You're the ones that are supposed to know Latin. Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. That is a huge slab of legislation on which a lot of our laws are based. Now this place, a little bit different. When the Bishop of Rome came into church, he walked, crozier, and then came into church. When the Bishop of Constantinople came into church, a little different. The Byzantine East expresses itself as a totality. There were 12 air conditioning vents around the entrance to the church. And in the bottom of the base, in the basement, just underneath them, just before the Bishop of Constantinople came in, the little old monk went shovel, 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 lots of incense. And then the whole entrance to the church was a billowy white cloud. There were 12 monks with huge reflecting mirrors that just before the Archbishop was coming in, they turned around and shone through the cloud. Bishop comes in, dressed in gold from top to toe, standing on a hydraulic hoist. Shovel, 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 shovel. Hydraulic hoist goes up. Said Bishop standing about head high. And then he comes into the, he gets wheeled into the church through this shining white cloud with the choir singing, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." You know, amazing stuff, really, when you think about it, how they wanted to, part of the faith was expressing who and what they are in their own specific way. See, people deal with life differently, therefore they express themselves differently. The basic starting point of prayer. A Christian is a person who prays, hopefully, sort of part of the whole job. That a Christian prays. Now, in the Eastern Church, I have a nephew who is now struggling his way through a book written by a gentleman called Origen on prayer. To read patristics is not just the job of the clergy or the seminarian. To have a patristic-based spirituality is that which applies to everybody. Two fundamental books. If you seriously want to pray, if you regard prayer as being something that actually you're supposed to do, there's a book which is essential, an essential starting point, really is. Its name is quite a simple one. It was written, it's called On Prayer, and it was written by a gentleman called Origen. It takes you through a whole lot of issues. One of the issues is purity. Purity. What? Is your prayer worth anything if you're not pure? Should you not strive to be a totally pure person? Perhaps so. When you read St. John Chrysostom on the priesthood, it's not about the priesthood. It's about searching, looking, trying to discover what God wants you to be. There's a lot of people that say, "Oh, I don't want to be a priest." Wrong question. Utterly the wrong question. I particularly didn't want to be a priest. Him. He had other matters. God told me I was going to be a priest, end of story. The more I decided that I didn't want to, the more God said, "Forget it now. Priesthood. Here I am today." I can't conceive of how a person could be in a seminary or looking or be in a convent, searching for vocation, trying to discover what God wants for me, from me, and this is an ongoing process, without reading John Chrysostom's On the Priesthood at least once a year. Yes, once a year, every year for the term of your natural life. If you don't, you're engaging in a process of self-deception. You have to and looking for all of this from the boys that did it many years ago. See, empires come and go,
But somehow Mother Church has been around for a long while. And the body of patristic literature, which was written over a period of, call it, 8 centuries, is on being a Christian for dummies. Read it, don't read it at your own peril. You know, what's he got to do with anything? What's he got to do with a talk about the Christian East? Stalin. The Communist Party. I have told our patriarch that we owe Stalin a huge debt of gratitude. When communism came to power in Western Ukraine, essentially Stalin arrested the church. And there were literally not absolutely literally speaking, rivers of blood. There have been thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people who gave their life for the faith. Now, these people didn't have to do so. They had a choice. They could have denied the Catholic Church and joined the Moscow Patriarchate. They chose not. They knew that their choice meant absolute, certain death. You know, when I went to Ukraine in 91, just before the Gorbachev Revolution, everybody said, forget the party. We're coming out of the underground, and they did. We had a difficult process that we had to go through to decide who was going to be in the cemetery. And at the end of it, a part of the process was you had to have somebody in your family, immediate family, that had died for the faith. And you have no idea what it is to speak to a person, to a priest. Looking around, how old are you? How old are you? 23. I served liturgy with a priest that was 21. He was from the underground church. And he was ordained a priest, not to be a priest, he was ordained to be a priest, knowing 100% that within the next 3 years, he was going to die a martyr's death. And when we were celebrating liturgy, I saw that he felt very uncomfortable. That I said, Father, what's the matter? There's no onion. No onion. For what? I said, Father, you always lived in a country where celebrated the holy mysteries, it was all legal. I risked my life every time I did. I would go to his house and we celebrate liturgy quietly whispering at 3 o'clock in the morning, and there was always a peeled onion on the table right next to the chalice. Why? Because very often the police would come in. Oh, the chalice was a coffee cup. Very often the police would come in and the priest would consume the gifts right away, consecrated or not, and then start biting an onion. Because the first thing the priests did, the people did, they lined everybody up and smelt their breath. Who had wine on his breath? That was the priest. They just take him up and shoot him on the spot. So an onion was a normal part of what one did. See, so that's why we are very grateful to this man. because we had always had a tradition of radical pacifism. There is nothing at all ever, period, that justifies having a gun. There is absolutely no justification for violence at all. Self-defense, not self-defense. No violence, period. That is why there is a church today. That is Patriarch Joseph. He was offered the job of to be Patriarch of Moscow, only deny the faith. Deny the faith, deny the Catholic Church, we'll put you in the top job in the Orthodox Church. He said in the greatest polite, most polite way, no. He couldn't say Mass, but he did. He found a crust of bread, and people gave the priests that were in the concentration camps, and there was hundreds of thousands of them, they sent them raisins. The priest put the raisin into the water, left it there overnight, and we count that as being wine. And so we start celebrating the liturgy using a little crust of bread and raisin water. Oh, I know the temple police would go to town on that, those are invalid Mass. Sorry, quite valid. This one, the Blessed Clement Shepetsky. He was responsible for reinvigorating the whole concept of Byzantine monasticism. When I mean monasticism, I mean, see, our monasticism was not one that the monastery was out in the middle of nowhere or on an inaccessible mountain. Ukrainian monasticism was always slap bang downtown. And these people brought the faith to the people. And again, they went back to patristic theology. Imagine John Chrysostom celebrating liturgy. Now, the reason why he has the name is because when he, just like going to church here in the UST, Father Winston said, "Sir, I came here, I said, what time do you have Mass?" "Oh, 6 o'clock. "That's mad. 6 o'clock in the morning, we're going to have Mass." "Said, who's going to be there?" "Who's going to be there?" I got up and found the church almost full every day. See, that's what John Chrysostom did. Believe me, it's a unique Filipino thing. You'll never find the churches as full anywhere in the world. No university in the world has that, period. Even Rome. Oh, Rome, especially Rome. Go to Rome and lose the faith. See, this boy here, he said, "No violence. You don't want me to celebrate the liturgy? Fine, kill me. You want to kill me? That's nice. Enjoy yourself." Now, this is nice, but why does this relate to me? After all, I'm a Filipino. Roman Catholic. Nice, but I'm pretty irrelevant. Good question. So let's have a look at the spirituality of these people and ask ourselves, why does the Pope want us to look at their spirituality? John Paul II wrote an encyclical called Orientale Lumen. Anybody that can vaguely know can translate that to Latin, from Latin? The Light of the East. Since, in fact, we believe that the venerable and ancient tradition of the Eastern churches is an integral part of the heritage of Christ's church. The first need for Catholics is to be familiar with that tradition so as to be nourished by it and to encourage the process of unity in the best way possible. Now, the Byzantine East has a unique spirituality. And we go from liturgy. The Roman Church goes from theology to liturgy. The Eastern Church does it the other way around. We go from liturgy to theology. A different approach of life. There is a high Christology. We start from the divinity of Christ, not starting from the humanity of Christ. As a rule, Latin theology will start from, it's not that one is correct and the other is incorrect, that it's a different way of looking at the whole concept of Christianity. There is a strong sense of pneumatology, a strong sense of the Holy Spirit, especially in the sacraments. And as the Pope says, Catholicity implies diversity. Question. This is not said in an aggressive manner. This is just asked in a matter for consideration. Where there is just, we live in the 21st century. I can take a picture of you and send it to the other side of the world all within 60 seconds. Times have changed. Communication now is different. Where communication is, where the church is just purely Latin in one country, or purely Byzantine in one country, is it Catholic? Is the church still Catholic there? Is it still a universal church? Something to give consideration to. Now, for you people that read, a good place to start to understand why the Pope's saying all of this is to read a book written by a gentleman called Aidan Nichols. AidanNichols. It's called Rome and the Eastern Churches. Oh yes, and the gentleman has an OP after his name. There's another gentleman who has SJ after his name, called Robert Taft, T-A-F-T. Now, Robert Taft is the Byzantine theologian of the second half of the 20th century. To be seriously studying Byzantine theology and not reading Robert Taft is an exercise in futility, pretty much. Now we go on. There is only one way which this can actually happen. You must have the opportunity to take part in Eastern liturgies, Eastern parishes, to become enriched by the Eastern spiritual tradition. Tomorrow, we are going to have, here in the seminary chapel, a liturgy of St. John Chrysostom, but we have put a lot of work into this liturgy. We do not believe in cultural imperialism. I have no interest in making you a Ukrainian. We lift up the Byzantine template and have tried to put it into a Filipino cultural environment. Not easy, will take years to perfect, but it is nonetheless a first attempt. To do this is really important. It's an important part of the whole exercise. But in Tala Lumen, from the beginning of the Christian East, has proved to contain a wealth of forms capable of assuming the characteristics of each other, individual culture, with supreme respect for each particular community. Pope said so. I'm not allowed to come and turn you into anything that you're not. The Pope said that the Eastern Church, the tradition of the Eastern Church, is point blank. We have to make it look as if it was born in the Philippines. Period. Otherwise, pack up and go away. We can only thank God with deep emotion for the wonderful variety which He has allowed, such as rich composite mosaic of different things to be formed. Now, what would a Filipino Byzantine look like? Wow. It's scary to think about.
let's have a look. There's a lot of different concepts that can happen. Now, what if? Yeah, fine. Two lungs. He believed that a balance must be restored, in which both Latin and Eastern traditions will contribute to the health of the church. Does this have any relevance to the University of St. Thomas and to yourselves? Now, there has to be a two-way exchange. The Eastern Church has a lot to learn from the Western Church. Reality. It's the way it is. The Western Church has a lot to learn from the East. That is also simply the way it is. Now let's go for a walk into a Byzantine church and let's see how the other half lives. That's what I see when I go into my parish church, the Cathedral of St. Peter and Paul in Melbourne. The Christmas icon, the iconostas, the resurrection icon, two seraphims. Now the Christmas icon, here, symbolism. Symbolism, symbolism, symbolism. You see, I had a brilliantly prepared speech, but after coming to the Philippines, I realized that I had to throw it away. I learned in a few days, I have learned so much. Some things, when you come here and try to use a little bit of vision and look at the world around you here, there's so much to learn. Creativity. Before coming in, I've already had three people under the age of 23 going through the process of becoming iconographers. Look on the Filipino Facebook page, the what's it called? Forgive my pronunciation. Mission Filipino Byzantino Catholico NG in a NG deals. Find it. There's a guy. He was a manga artist. Did Japanese cartoons for crying out loud. He did a resurrection icon. Halfway between the manga and classic iconography. There's people that are, as we speak, creating a base of Filipino music to pray in this environment. When you come from the Bahamas, you're a fairly smart guy. You came from a barrio quite a long way away. And you think to yourself, nice. But to me, this is irrelevant. You go into your barrio and you find a little old lady or a young kid. Doesn't really talk. Doesn't really talk and can't really pray. But he's got golden hands. He can draw. You take him to a place like this and you let him loose just to have a look and pray with his hands. We'll go back to that later on. So this isn't just an abstract talk. This is something for you. This is something that you can make uniquely your own and take it home. Because there are people. The reason why this happened was because we accepted the fact that there are people that
Everybody needs to pray and wants to pray, but there are some people that don't do it there or there. There are people that do it this way. I'm not going to go into details about the iconostasis, the symbolism. Google and you'll find it all, and you'll find it all. But this is what you see. This is the whole visual aspect of what is seen. The nativity icon. Let's go through a little bit of symbolism. Concentric circles going from light to dark. In Byzantine iconography, that is the symbol for eternity. There is only one who is eternal, and that is God. Standard angels. Angel 1, 2, 3. And Father and Holy Spirit, God, pointing down to Him. Standard people, three kings, shepherds, only in this case, shepherds are totally Ukrainian. Hey, Ukrainian icon, Ukrainian shepherds, what do you want? And down here, St. Joseph, being not really happy about this, not impressed at all, looking the other way, is being tempted by the devil to say, ha, going to have to dump this woman, there's enough's enough. And then God reveals to him what is happening. There is only one rock symbolizing that this is just the beginning, the Old Testament, where there are two rocks, two buildings, the Old and the New Testament. And the whole concept of color and facial expressions, size of mouth, all of these things have symbolism. The resurrection icon, see the two rocks in the background, Old Testament, New Testament, white over concentric circles going from light to dark. King Solomon, King David. John the Baptist two of the apostles. And Adam and Eve being taken out of the grave. Christ is standing on a cross. No, he's not. No cross at all. Christ is standing on the coffin lids of Adam and Eve. Talk about resurrection, Michael, and the development of theology in the Byzantine East. I'm talking out of school. I'll get into trouble from the boss, but he can deal with it. But he can deal with it later. This Filipino kid that did the resurrection icon, his Adam and Eve were 16 year olds. And I said to him, why did you make Adam and Eve as 16 year olds? They're always portrayed as old people. And he looked at me as if I was a complete idiot. And not far from the truth. He looked at me as if I was quite mad, and he said, sin is gone, their sins are forgiven. They look like they did in the Garden of Eden. It's obvious. I said, well, now here am I trying to intellectualize Eastern theology going from this way to this way. Perfect example. Theology going from art, looking at iconography and developing a theology from the revelation of God. Just get at the revelation from God, pure and simple. It is impossible to say that he didn't. And yes, I have referred to this matter to significant authorities. They looked at that and said, yep, straight hand of God stuff. No, it's lots of babies. We have to revise the books. Not a joke. Not even a little bit of a joke, my people, my friends. A significant theological development happened in this country
from a kid that's never had a day of theology or never had a day of art school. Why did God want to speak through his hands? If anybody's got the answer, he's way smarter than me, because I don't know. But God decided to speak through his hands in a significant way, and happened here and follows that tradition. This is the bishop's teaching chair. It is not a throne. It is not a throne. Bishops don't sit on thrones. Only medieval princes do. In the old days, by the way, Christ the High Priest, in the old days, the theologian or the priest or the bishop would sit in a chair with a group of people around him teaching. Usually he was a bald old man by the time he got to be a teacher. Sun came on his head. So he wanted an umbrella. This canopy is a symbolism of an umbrella sitting above a teacher's chair. Why? Because that is the most important thing that a bishop could possibly do. He could be a great administrator. He could be a phenomenal diplomat. But at the end of the day, his job description and responsibility is to teach the word of God. May the blessing of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit remain with you all the days of your life. Boys and girls, that means nothing. Symbolism. When a priest gives a blessing, that's the way you hold your fingers. Symbolizing. The first two letters of the name of Jesus Christ, ICXC. I bless you in the name of Jesus, not in the name of a waving of a hand. I bless you in the name of Jesus. How do you make the sign of the cross? Three fingers. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In the dual natures of Christ. Humanity and divinity. You bless yourself in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Hold three fingers as equals. Together they represent patristic teaching. The Trinity, God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. These are not three gods, but one God in Trinity. The names are separate, but the divinity is one. The Father was never incarnate, the Son incarnate, but not created. The Holy Ghost is neither incarnate nor created, but issued from the Godhead. Three in a single divinity. Divinity is one force and has one honor. They receive obeisance from all creation, both angels and people. Thus the decree for these three fingers. You should hold the two other fingers slightly bent, but not completely straight. This is because they represent the dual natures of Christ, divine and human. God in his divinity and human in his incarnation, yet perfect in both. The upper fingers represent the divinity and the lower the humanity. This way salvation goes from the higher finger to the lower. So is the bending of the three fingers interpreted, for the worship of heaven comes down for our salvation. This is how you must cross yourself and give a blessing as the Holy Fathers have commanded. Good enough. Who has never done? Put your hand up. I don't see anybody putting their hands up. I myself cannot put my hand up.
I have done. Yeah, you know. Bring what they say. Scary stuff. I told you to hold to right to left, not left to right. Sister, third from the right. Bang, you. On which side of the Father does Christ sit? Right? Wonderful. Make her Reverend Mother. So we bless ourselves in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the right to left. When you bless yourself left to right, you say Christ sits at the left hand of the Father. Not particularly correct, if I may be so extremely careful as to delicately say. Look at the little kid and look what he's saying Right to left. Now, Jesus' prayer. One of these. Or one of these. Same thing. The name of the Lord Jesus Christ is a divine name. The power and effect of that name are divine, omnipotent and salvific, and transcend our ability to comprehend them. With faith, therefore, with confidence and sincerity, and with great piety and fear, ought we to proceed to the doing of the great work which God has entrusted us, to train ourselves in prayer by using the name of the Lord. Ah, that's nice. I say the rosary. Not a rosary. Different concept. Different purpose. This, we constantly say, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God. Why is this tassel at the end of it? It's not a decoration. It is there for a practical purpose. Sister number one with her tassel. What is this tassel for? Any idea? When you just... Oh, yeah, that one with the glasses. Yes, you're right. What is the tassel for? I'm an old man. Loudly and clearly.
If I'm not mistaken, that tassel symbolizes God's presence in the Old Testament. I'm not particular with the exact chapter and verse, but that's on the book of Numbers, I think.
Sure. But it has a practical sense. Its significance within this concept is to wipe away your tears. Your tears when you discover that you are a sinful person. See, you laugh and you think it's funny. But who of you understands his sinfulness? Do you understand his sinfulness? This is the tool to understand your sinfulness. Whether you're in Manila, Bulacan, Mindanao, trust me, you're still really competent at sinning. And you probably enjoy your sins, otherwise you wouldn't have done them. Who doesn't enjoy their sins? If you don't enjoy them, stop doing them. Not very smart of them. See, these are people who have lost the concept of sinfulness. I repeat, these are people who have lost the concept of how to sin. They're monks. They are great schema monks. They have been given the angelic habit.
They will never be given a position of responsibility in the monastery. They will never end up in the rota of who says what mass. They live a totally independent life that everybody in the monastery, no matter how important he thinks he is, just gives way in total submission to these gentlemen. If there was a visiting monastery, for instance, here, the Archbishop of Manila, no ifs, buts, or maybes, would go to one of them to confession. Weekly, the president of Manila, if he did not go to confession to one of these boys, that would be a most unfortunate thing for his political future. They are known to be people, and there are such people, who within the monastic world have lost the concept of sinfulness. They have succeeded in this. This for them has become obsolete. Don't know about you. That scares the hell out of me. I feel very uncomfortable if I had to compare myself spiritually to something like that. An icon. What's an icon? We were talking earlier on. An icon is a prayer in form and color. Ladies and gentlemen, an icon is not a holy picture. It is not liturgical art. It is a prayer in form and color. Before an iconographer begins his icon, he goes to confession. He fasts and meditates for 40 days on what God wants him to write in that. You don't paint icons, you write them. What does God want me to say in this icon? And yes, when you do all your prayers right, God will tell you. Guys doing icons in the church. The eyes, the mouth, all of these things have meaning. Done in the Philippines, the facial features should be different. Why? Well, I'll tell you. That Jesus looks pretty much Ukrainian. Go to a Greek church, they look Greek. Go to a Russian church, they're all very skinny and gaunt, look as if they've just walked out of a concentration camp. they're all thin, oh, they're not skinny people. Why should the Philippines imitate somebody else? Iconography in the Philippines is Filipino. The purpose of icons is to create the reverence in worship and second to serve and exist as an existential link between the worshipper and God. Icons have been called prayers, hymns, sermons, and form of color. They are the individual gospel, blah, 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 blah. That, you get the idea. Baptism. Total immersion. That's an old one. Look at the kid. Baptism, chrismation, and Eucharist are all presented at the same time. Now, when you baptize a child, do you hold the child like so when you pour a little bit of holy water on top of his head? That total immersion is a symbol of rising together with Christ and your sins going away. Pouring a little bit of water on the head is a symbol of doing that. So when you baptize somebody by pouring water on his head, you're doing a symbol of a symbol. You're doing a symbol of a symbol. There is more mercy in God than there are sins. Confession is cool. what a priest looks like. Maybe that's what a priest looks like. Note, that's a deacon during the liturgy. That was done in Hong Kong. Note, the word, that was the first time in Christian history last year that the word holy was written on the orarium in Chinese. Next time we come, very, very soon, we'll have a Byzantine deacon in the Philippines with similar thing. That's the vestment of an archdeacon. That is an archdeacon. It's an archdeacon. What's the difference between a priest and a monsignor? Nothing. What's the difference? Nice fashion accessories. Then what's the difference between a deacon and an archdeacon? Fashion accessories. The structure of the liturgy of preparation. Preparation is done quietly. The liturgy of catechumens. Focal point is the gospel. Then the liturgy. Oh, that's the icon that the Filipino kid did. The first impression that a lot of people in Ukraine got, he's got a Filipino face. That hand is why they started saying hand of God. The second hand of God icon, no issues. It's hand of God. Nobody can do hands like that. To do that a hand with that detail requires 20 years of practice of iconography. It is impossible for a person who is 20 years old with zero iconography to do that, the hand like that, unless it's a divine intervention straight. God wanting to say something. God is hitting us over the head extremely heavily and telling us something. Why did God choose the Philippines to produce that? I'm not God, and I'm not going to answer. But if you say, what has the Byzantine Church got to offer the Philippines? Well, that's one thing that's done already. And God made sure it happened. Certainly wasn't any achievement of mine. The beginning prayers in front of the iconostas, the vesting prayers, putting on your vestments. Now this is an altar. How to build an altar was written very specifically in the book of Revelations. It's supposed to be as wide as it is long as it is high. It's supposed to be the perfect cube. If God says that, hey, I'm not going to start telling him I want to build something else. I'm not going to tell him I've got a better idea. God is God. He's been doing his job for a long time. Seven-branch candlestick and the two seraphs at the back of the crucifix. We'll talk about the tabernacle a bit later. This is a prosphora. That's from which the communion bread is baked. Yes, it rises. It has yeast. It's real bread. The cutting of the prosphora, that's what the preparation of the gifts looks like. A priest doing prosphora. By the way, Dominican. Chinese Dominican in Hong Kong. Father Christopher. Starting the liturgy. Blessed is the kingdom. The prayer of Justinian. This is celebrated. This is sung during the liturgy. This is a definition. It was put into the liturgy during the... Is Jesus God or Jesus man? This is a definition of the person of Jesus Christ. Only begotten Son and Word of God, you immortal, became for us our salvation to be made flesh. Of the Mother of God and of the Virgin Mary, without undergoing change, you became man. You are crucified, O Christ, O God, and you trampled death by death. You who are one in the Holy Trinity and glorified with the Father and the Holy Spirit, save us. This is a rather charming priest giving a blessing. Holding his hand correctly like that. the Tresarion, just the Son just before the Epistle and the Gospel. Now, that makes a statement. We, in Australia, the Church of Australia, is going through huge changes. If we want to remain a Byzantine church and not turn into a museum, it's easy to turn into an ecclesiastical museum. Just look, if a Greek priest goes and said, comes to the Philippines and celebrates in Greek, he's making a joke of himself. He's playing a sarcastic joke. If you want to be Orthodox, sorry, if you want to be a Byzantine Catholic, you have to enculturate. That my parents, i.e. the grandparents of these kids, were Ukrainian, they came from Ukraine, they're very Ukrainian, blah, 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 blah. Anybody in his 20s is not Ukrainian anymore, he's an Aussie. And I told the guy that's the conductor, write a liturgy from your own musical experience. Do not use church music at all as a base, as a starting point. Use that which is in your mind to express music that you praise. And it's not easy for an established church to acknowledge the fact that it is different and that times have changed and it has to change. The deacon about to read the gospel, the cherubic hymn, invites us to forget about our worldly cares and orient ourselves solely to God now. Sit back and enjoy the ride. And remember what I said about us changing.
Thank you.
illustrates several things. One, the whole concept of changing society, accepting the fact that these are people from urban Australia, not come from Ukraine. But there's another thing. The Byzantine Church is essentially a monastic spirituality, but its music never comes from the top. The music comes from the bottom, from the village, from the people. You know, the Ukrainian church is something that I said to Father Winston, to the fathers in the monastery, says, you know, this is a bit creepy being living in the fields, you know, because it's just like a tropical Ukraine. Then same dance, same thing. That who are the great composers of ecclesiastical music in the Filipino village in the barrio? I'll tell you who it is. The little old ladies. They're screech. Classic. In Ukraine and in the Philippines, it's the same thing. The great composers of music are little old ladies that are in church every day, sun up and sundown. Tell me I'm wrong. The beginning of the great entrance before the consecration, here is something important. The creed, note to the tabernacle, we're going to the priest procession, I'm going to do something now. There are three types of tabernacles. A dove. See the little door there? That's where we put the gifts. That's the church. A church. Here is the oldest and most important parts of tabernacle. The Ark of the Covenant. Where are the directions found? Look in the Bible, you'll find out. Note that the tabernacle is wood. In the directions in the Old Testament, has to be gold plate. Mistake. Imp and imp, the two angels' heads, they start sparking. They start sparking, honestly. And there were too many recorded priestly deaths of the spark hitting father. And without going into the theology of the little old lady about the state of father's soul, the church decided to say, we follow the instructions except we just leave them as wooden now for the safety's sake. The creed, filioque or not, no sensible theologian is going to say that you have to say that the Father proceeds from the Father, the Son. The whole filioque argument is now dead. Anybody who wants to resurrect it is talking, well, if you're wrong. Consecration is what it looks like. You'll find out tomorrow. Infant communion. Absolutely normal. You know, I had a priest that once said, but Father, you people give a child communion before the age of reason. Yes, we do actually. And he says, but what if that child dies before it receives religious instruction? It's okay. I'll give God faculties to teach the kid, to teach the kid in heaven. The end. Now, I deliberately wanted to give you a pan view of the concept. I haven't answered all your questions yet. But my intention was to introduce, to provide you with an opportunity to see what it looks like. Knock yourselves out.
Thank you for giving your questions, clarifications, or any sharing of your reflections or thoughts about our lecture. There are two available mics at the back.
and maybe here in front. Oh, there is some sort here. So, yes, any questions, clarifications? This is now the time for our open forum.
See, some of you are going to be having significant leadership roles in the church in the future. It's important for you from early days to be aware that there's large parts of the church with different ways of doing things. Okay, first question.
Good afternoon, I'm Josephine Lucas. I would just want to share what I am teaching. But anyway, I heard this from a father, our Catholic Western father, a priest. In making the sign of the cross, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, that is the Catholic Western way of making the sign of the cross. Because from the West to the East, we are Roman Catholic, so our faith is coming from the West, going to the East. So, you reinterpret your making the sign of the cross in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit from the East going to the West, and then I make a play. One child is coming from the East to the West, and another is coming from the West to the East, and they meet each other at the middle, and then they pray the Hail Mary. Angel Gabriel will say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. And then Mama Mary gets up and approaches Elizabeth, who tells her, Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. And then two other kids will come around, and then Mary in front. They are all praying to her, Holy Mary, Mother of God. And then that's how we show our tie with the Eastern Catholic Church. Thank you.
A little bit about where you come from. My classmate is something.
Enlightening lecture. And it is really very interesting to have you here. Because in the lecture room, we have already heard about the Byzantine rites and the Latin rites. And it's a pity you have closed the chapter on the Philologue. I would like you to remember that I have a lot of questions, but I would like you to remember as you close it. So, my other questions are the lumen, I mean the Oriental lumen, but I tell them, the Pope gave throw a door open for the East and the Latin Church to meet. If I may ask you, you have thought a lot about the symbolism and the differences To what extent have the Ukrainian Church and the Holy See? To what extent have they been able to come together to iron out the perceived differences?
No, it's not a matter of differences. It's not, that's not the issue. Differences. The issue is, as I was trying to point out during the lecture, there's different people express themselves in different ways. God has come and spoken to different people and inspired them to holiness. He inspired St. Thomas Aquinas to holiness. He inspired Eastern saints as well. And the Pope wants us all to share in the inspiration that God has given to different people from different places.
But when we are talking on the University Church, we are talking in one voice, we are talking in one faith, trying to understand each other. I think that was what the Pope was saying, the right and the west, I mean the right and the Ukrainian church to meet together at a point.
No, not to meet together at a point and to become homogeneous. We're not going to become homogeneous. No matter how much Father Ed sitting next to you is of Chinese ethnicity, you're of African ethnicity, Father Winston is of Filipino ethnicity, I'm from Ukrainian ethnicity. No matter how much we try, we're not going to be the same. But I can learn from him, I can learn from him, I can learn from you, you can learn from me, you can learn from him. We can all interreact and learn from each other. For everybody to become homogeneous and the same is not going to happen, and nobody wants it to happen. We want to be able to develop the richness of everybody in their own way.
Okay, Les. What can I call, what do you call the...
Chotke, the Jesus prayer. A prayer room.
Something like the rosary?
No, nothing like the rosary. It has a different purpose entirely. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. This is called the angelic knot. You tie this, YouTube, Facebook, everywhere there's descriptions of how to tie. This is a different concept of praying to the rosary. The rosary is one thing, but saying it's bad. This is different. Not the same thing.
But when I saw it first, I thought it was something like the Muslim beads.
Yeah, where do you think they got it from? Where do you think the Muslims got it from? From this. The Muslims got their beads from this thing.
Okay, finally.
Nah, give it another two.
Giving communion to a small child.
Yeah.
Does the small child understand what he is receiving?
No.
So what's the purpose?
What's the purpose?
What's the purpose?
Either the person is a Christian or he's not. Either he's a child of God or he's not a child of God. Point blank.
Again, on baptism. Somebody, if it is to be used in immersion, complete immersion, what in... So, say in Africa, where there are a lot of desert, arid desert area, there is no water to immerse.
Can you turn it on again? That's not in China, my friend. That is in Nigeria.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. The child does not understand what he is receiving.
No. But the child is a Christian.
Well,
who is to forbid a Christian from receiving the body and blood of Christ? I myself wouldn't dare. The child in good time will come to a further review. Do I think a 20-year-old knows anything? A 20-year-old knows nothing except for the fact that he is selfish. When the 20-year-old will be a 60-year-old, he will still know that he knows nothing.
Yeah.
So does that kid know nothing?
Yeah. Yes.
Now I know how much I don't know.
That's true. But before we receive communion...
Thank you for the affirmation.
Before we receive communion, we are first of all taught who is God? Why are we receiving the communion? What is the communion going to do to us?
Now we're having this discussion. You are thinking as a Western person. I am thinking as an Eastern person. As an Eastern Christian, I say, this kid's a Christian. This Christian, since time immemorial, the church has done baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist in the same hit. Ask the teachers of liturgy. You give communion, baptism,
confirmation and Eucharist in the same ceremony. And if you've given the kid Eucharist once, I'll tell you how to do it. You put a little bit of wine in the spoon, you put a bit of wine in, it's very sweet wine. And you put the little bit of sweet wine in the kid's mouth, and the kid will go, put some more. Trust me. And when you baptize a little boy, be very careful. Make sure that it's back towards you. But if it's his face towards you, when you lift a child out of warm water, accidents happen.
Master, what is it is important to use just pour a little water on the pot on the head of the person?
I explained that before, that this baptism is a symbol of leaving sin behind. When you pour a little bit of water on the head, that is a symbol of doing that, and it becomes a symbol of a symbol.
Well, as I was saying,
last question, five questions.
In that Africa, really? In that Africa, there are places where you won't find that kind of water to immerse. Then, using sprinkling is the most sensible thing to do, I think.
Well, you've got a right to an opinion, and thank you for that opinion.
Thank you.
Thank you, Father. Thank you. Still have so many things to learn in my dear class. Yes.
Father, I'm Brother Bart from the Mariens of the Immaculate Conception. We were founded in Poland, and we have a lot of bi-ritual fathers in our congregation also.
Yes. Could you speak a little slower and a little louder?
Okay. I like your sense of humor.
Me too, thank you.
I'm frequently asked by this question, Father. The use of living bread in your Eucharist, can you shed some more, like, history, not too long history, but why do you use living bread, and when Jesus used unleavened bread during the Passover?
A, we're not in the Passover, but I will tell you, it is harder for a Western Christian to accept that his wafer is bread than to accept the doctrine of transubstantiation. That's a Byzantine joke. The leavened bread, we are not, if we celebrate just at the Passover, unleavened bread. But when we celebrate liturgy tomorrow, it's not going to be Passover time. There's not a more complicated explanation than that. As a rule, ladies and gentlemen, the simplest explanation is the truthful explanation. When you get somebody coming out with explanations that are very complicated and, you know, this way and that way, it's usually not particularly true. Especially in the history of the church, most explanations are very simple and to the point. Yes. That's it.
Anyone else?
Yeah.
Yes.
Get up and ask a question.
Good afternoon, Brother Bayou, pastor of Brother. I do believe that the Blessed Virgin Mary is has a special place in our heart as Catholic, both in Western Church and Eastern Church.
Yeah.
Perhaps from your perspective, can you share to us how special she is in your heart? Coming from the extension.
Come to tomorrow, and I'm not avoiding your question. Come to the liturgy tomorrow, and that question will be answered. No, that is not meant as being amusing or a joke. I'm being quite serious. That exact question will be answered by you taking part in the liturgy. You will understand. I can trot out explanations, but they will not be as satisfactory as you taking part in the liturgy. Somebody that is not one of their classmates. Sister, do you have a question? Dear God in heaven. A gaggle of nuns and not a single question. Are you a classmate?
I'm a major seminary in Bulacan. First, I want to congratulate you with a beautiful presentation and quite light for a seemingly complex topic. So my question is this. You mentioned about something about enculturation. So I have a simple question. Is it possible or is it allowable to the Eastern Rite to celebrate the liturgy, for example, in Filipino?
My friend, you answer the question. He's going to be the choir. Come. He's going to be the choir director for the liturgy.
Last Sunday we celebrated the Divine Liturgy in Bulacan in Filipino and in English. Our songs are in Filipino. Some are my. I put melody. Some of the melody in it to have a taste of to have it. So that the liturgy will have a taste of Filipino music, a little bit. So, yes, it was possible.
This is a process. This is only the first time. In Philippines, it's a question of language. It's a question of quite simply most priests that can't really celebrate most. Most priests can't celebrate the singing the liturgy in Tagalog yet, because we have to get the words right. But then there's also the concept of Vicar, and any other. Hang on, this works. And then we will the concept of Vicar and all the other languages and dialects in the Philippines. But then I'm discussing. I'm still on a learning curve. I'm in a huge curve of discovery, which is going to take many years. That I've discovered that, especially in the church, English is still a significant language. Yes, sir.
No, I have no seminary. I'm going to ask two questions. First, about what is your take on the theological concept of original sin, and second, about the concept of purgatory, because I know I have encountered some Eastern Orthodox friend of mine who says that they do not believe on the concept of purgatory, but they are believing that there's a concept of final purification. And second, yes, about the concept of the original sin, because they do not believe that original sin can be transmitted by blood, because if we know in the...
Say that again, original sin?
The original sin is not transmitted by means of blood coming from the hereditary, what I mean is hereditary ones, because it was fixed in the Latin Rite theology that the original sin came from our first parents, Adam and Eve, right? But they do not believe on that, so they believe, because of that, they believe that the Blessed Virgin Mary has the original sin. That's my question, Father.
Well, His Holiness the Pope came out with something about purgatory that is perfectly acceptable to the Eastern mind. That he said, purgatory is not a place. You first, the second row that was shaking head, you agree? Yes, me. Do you agree with what I just said? Purgatory is not a place? What is it? Microphone. Go to a microphone and say what it is. Purgatory is not a place, but...
According to my theology teacher, it is a state.
A state of mind? A state of being? A state of what? Fine, you're doing well. Thank you. That's good. It's a state of... Yes, sir. Very good. Give the man an ice cream.
that purgatory is not a place. Purgatory is a concept, a state of being. It's something that happens rather than somewhere you go to. Oh dear God, I remember in the Christian Brothers High School, you do your confession on the first Friday, do the Stations of the Cross, you get 10 years of purgatory for every station. So we were running around the Stations of the Cross 10, 15 times. They gave us a little passbook in which we were to write out how many years of purgatory we were going to get for doing that. And Benedict, by the grace of God, may the Lord preserve and bless his soul, tells us that they were talking nonsense. That said, that purgatory is a concept, it's a state of being, gentlemen. This is what the Byzantine East has said all along, and His Holiness the Pope has now said, this is what we all believe. This is what it really is. If anybody chooses to say that His Holiness is incorrect, that is nice, but I myself would rather not. I rather suspect His Holiness the Pope knows what he's talking about. And His Holiness has merely reiterated the teachings of the Eastern Fathers from time immemorial. And this is what I'm talking about. Exchanging your concepts, exchanging your understanding. When I went to the Teze prayers last night, it's like being in the Eastern Church. Nothing Latin about it at all. That, you see, the Eastern mind, look at his face. Look at my face. I am the Oriental Christian. He is the Westerner. Please explain to me the sanity in that. The Eastern Church, they're going to so make fun of you at the dinner table tonight. The Eastern Church has a concept of quiet, of silence, which the Latin Church simply doesn't have. You constantly have to be twanging a guitar or making some kind of noise. The Eastern Church has got a huge concept of silence, of prayer of the heart, of contemplation. And when I went to the Teze prayers last night, it was extremely Eastern. So again, what I'm saying, an exchange of gifts. Nobody's talking about being temple police and boot-clicking stormtroopers. Lord, do I love the temple police. That if we are serious about praying, something like this is fundamental. If we are serious about praying, to read Origin on Prayer is fundamental. If we are serious about praying, silence is fundamental. Come and sister, at least one of the sisters. One little question, not a big one. Just one. Please. Yay!
Going to ask a question to you is, there's a confirmation about that you told a while ago about your prayer that you have that in your mind? Because the one that you're holding, that one, when you're saying, have mercy,
Lord Jesus Christ,
Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me, a sinner. When we have a prayer in the evening prayer, when we say, instead for us to say the Psalm 51, then our superior will, or whoever is the leader of the liturgy of that hour, we say spontaneous. I always say that prayer. Now I understand that it comes from your church, but it do have really an importance of when you see kasi that one every day. It is also a mantra for me.
Yes.
That is a confirmation that it really does help.
See, when you thank you, sister, very, very much. I was talking about that when you say, we're Roman Catholics. See, you shouldn't be pushing your nose into here. Well, I'm not. She's praying the Eastern way for years. She's not the only one. There's kids doing iconography for here, for goodness sake. The whole concept of praying in the way the Eastern Church does has been popping up all over the place in these Philippine Islands for a long time. Am I pushing my luck to hope for a second sister? Yes, come on, just another one. Just another one. There's three in a row smiling and nudging the other one to get up. Oh. You can't see that I can.
Father, I have a question.
So,
my name is Bien from the Graduate School of Liturgy. I have noticed when James gave me a task regarding the anaphora, I've noticed that in the anaphora of the Eastern Rite, the do this in memory is not present, while in the anaphora...
Excuse me, say again.
The do this in memory is not present in the anaphora of the Eastern Church, while in the Western, or in our anaphora, the do this in memory is there. Why is it in the Eastern, it is not being mentioned?
Ask John Chrysostom. There are Eucharistic prayers in the Catholic Church which don't, in the Catholic Church, yes, please understand that, which don't mention the words of institution at all. There are anaphoras in the Catholic Church which do not mention the words of Jesus at all, but are still official Catholic prayers. That there are different forms of expression, and as I said, right. It isn't that one is wrong. They come from different historical perspectives.
Thank you, brother. Unfortunately, we have to entertain another last one question. It's a lecture. Sorry, Father.
I can't entertain you. I'll tell you why. He's a Dominican. He's a Jesuit and he's a Benedictine. They've taken away all my jokes. I can't do any Jesuit jokes, for God's sake. He's sitting here. Who said I can't? Listen, when I was in Angelicum, there was this, the one in Rome, St. Thomas University, there was this little old priest, maybe that one. He was going on, you know, about orthodoxy, about orthodox isn't a religion, orthodox is being true believing Christians. He was going, moral theology, teaching this, teaching that, talking about this, talking about that. And he just turns around, holding his pen, slams it on the table and says, and gentlemen, I'll have you know, he's an Irish Dominican, and gentlemen, I'll have you know, it's no very great sin to be throwing a rock through a Jesuit window. And then there was this Jesuit, God bless his sweet soul. Gives me a long, hard look. And said, so, you went to Angelicum.
Yes.
Have you sold your soul to scholasticism? And then I says, no, Father.
I took my censor and hit the moral theology professor over the head and killed him. And then, of course, I was a seminary rector for 4 years in Ukraine. I had a seminary of 300. Oh, no. Temple police joke. Does any liturgical fascists here? Any serious right wing, serious boot pick? Is there any temple police? No. Fine. To tell my temple, all the temple police jokes I like. That I was sitting in the class. It's like this university here. Every seminary had its own particular cassock. And we had a Ukrainian cassock, and one of the legionnaires of one of these right-wing groups gave me a filthy look and then asked the same moral philosophy prof that I just talked about, says, "Father, is it okay if priests marry?" Looking at me, knowing that Eastern priests marry. And he, without batting an eyelid, the dear guy said, "Only if they love each other." Too many Dominicans, too many Jesuits and Benedictines now. They've taken away all my jokes. But mind you, they make very good alcohol, the Benedictines. Much better than the Dominicans. The Benedictine alcohol is quite a lot going for it. Anybody else have anything else to say? Yes, Father.
This one from
the university. It's a very important man.
My question is, you made a pointed question of what it is for me, a Filipino and Roman Catholic. And in the end, I was thinking that probably you would discuss about how would a Filipino Eastern Christian look like.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time. It is time. This is a smartphone as opposed to a dumb phone. You can access any information here. We now all live in the 21st century in a time where information is everywhere. There are many reasons which keep on popping up why there should be, let us call it, a Byzantine church presence, a permanent Byzantine church presence in the Philippines. It's time. God has been hitting us on the head with many, many things. I'm not here because I invited myself or because I particularly wanted to come. I'm here because there were a lot of people that quite frankly bullied me into coming. That they were saying, it's time you came to Manila. It's time you came to the Philippines. We need the Eastern Church. And I said, why do you need the Eastern Church? You're all Filipino, Roman Catholic, Spanish flavor for that sake. So why do you need the Eastern Church? That's exactly why we do. And then, so far, I've got three iconographers under the age of 23 in the Philippines, one of whom the people in authority have said, flat, hand of God. I find that very scary. I came here
And last Wednesday, there were a group of young people who knew zippity-doo-da-day, nothing about the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom. Now they're singing it in a Filipino way, as if this is what they've been praying for the whole of their lives, as if they never were Roman Catholics. Mm-hmm. They're singing the liturgy as if this is what they were born into. This, again, is classic hand of God. Could he have done that by himself? No. Could I have taught them in 3 days? Nah. Silly. It's another one of these classic God moments. And there's so many artists, music people. We don't have composers of liturgical music. We have a few, but they're irrelevant. He chooses to dispute that. Quite frankly, you're mad. Come tomorrow and see. Come tomorrow and see what the answer to Father's question is. That there are a lot of things happening spontaneously from the ground that are creating a Filipino Byzantine tradition. The iconography that people will take back to the barrio. The music that the barrio will write. Who will write the liturgies? The 80-year-old woman. She'll write the liturgies for you. Why? God will inspire her. And it's scary coming to church here. When I got up for 6 o'clock and saw 2,000 odd students praying, I wasn't quite sure that was this done for my sake, some kind of circus that they put on? Nah, that's what happens here. Doesn't happen anywhere else. I'll tell you how many people go to church at the Catholic University of Australia. About 20. They have church once a month and once a week. Oh, 20 might come. That's about it. You've got something unique here. You've got something that simply doesn't happen. The whole concept of prayer, the whole concept of family, the whole concept of relationships. This is stuff which is creating from the ground up a Byzantine church right here, which will be bringing a lot of people to Christ. Am I saying what is the problem? What you are, or can you? Do you want to follow that up with another question?
Thank you, Father, for that powerful words. And about that tomorrow, it will be at USD Central Seminary Chapel at 3 p.m. And thank you, Father, for that last and final question. And because of that, may I ask you to climb up here on stage together with Father Rodel Pialigan, the Dean of the Sacred Theology and the President of the Theological Society Seminarian Ryan J. Deposoy, to give our speaker the tokens and the certificate. I will read the certificate. The Faculty of Sacred Theology, the Pontifical and Royal University of Santo Tomas, the Catholic University of the Philippines, awards this certificate of appreciation to Right Reverend Olexander Kenez in recognition to his valuable contribution as speaker in the International Lecture for Theology, the witness of the Eastern Catholic Churches in the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, sponsored by the USD Faculty Sacred Theology in cooperation with the USD Theological Society and the Office of the Vice Rector for Religious Affairs. November 13, in the year 2012, at CME Auditorium Ground Floor Medicine Building here at USD University of Santo Tomas, signed by our Dean, Reverend Father Rodel Pialigan from the Order of Preachers and the Rector of the University of Santo Tomas, Reverend Father Herminio Dagohoy, OP. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Father.